Assalamu alaikum. This is a continuation of the previous video on amino acid high yield products and diseases. In the past video, we discussed the summary of metabolism and discussed the hydrophobic half of the amino acids. In this video, we will focus on hydrophilic. It's important to note that the past video is very highly related to this one, as we will build up concepts in between those amino acids. Starting with serine and threonine. Those two amino acids have in common a hydroxyl group in their side chain, and that oxygen of the hydroxyl group serves for two important chemical reactions when they are present in proteins, the first being phosphorylation. Enzymes are proteins, and they have several amino acids. At the site of serine or threonine is exactly where phosphorylation happens, and this phosphorylation serves for activation or deactivation of enzymes. Now moving on to the second type of chemical reaction, glycosylation. You know how DNA codes for amino acids in a process known as transcription. Then the rough endoplasmic reticulum packages the respective amino acids and attaches them into a protein. This is known as translation. And then the last step, it happens in the Golgi, which is known as post-translational modifications, just preparing the protein for the outside world. One of the preparations is known as glycosylation, which is basically just attaching a glucose on the amino acid to identify as self for the immunity. Now we'll focus on serine. Serine is synthesized from glycolysis. This is the fourth time probably I mentioned this. And it further synthesizes glycine and cysteine. It is as well a precursor of sphingosine. Sphingosine is a major component of the lipid membrane and the precursor of folate. Folate is a vitamin that is vital for DNA replication and cell division. Next is cysteine and methionine. We'll start with methionine as it will eventually lead to cysteine. And a major characteristic of methionine is that it is a methyl donor. And if you recall from the past video, when we were discussing the phenylalanine and tyrosine derivatives, at the very last step, we had norepinephrine forming epinephrine with the aid of something known as S-adenosyl methionine, which is a derivative of methionine. Another characteristic of methionine is that, you know, when you form the sequence of amino acids in a protein, methionine is the first. That's why it is involved in the initiation of a protein buildup. Now, in order to understand the clinical association for methionine, we have to go through the methionine metabolic cycle. So we'll start off here, where methionine is converted to S-adenosyl methionine, which is a methyl donor, as you mentioned earlier. It will give its methyl group to a methyl acceptor such as norepinephrine, or even, I didn't mention this earlier, purines or pyrimidines, and there are other examples as well. We will get a product known as homocysteine. This homocysteine has the choice of going into two paths, either being recycled back to methionine with the aid of two very important vitamins, vitamin B12 and tetrahydrofolate, which is basically vitamin folate, catalyzed by an enzyme known as methionine synthase. The name makes perfect sense. Synthase is synthesis, and methionine, it will form methionine eventually. Or the homocysteine can go and join serine. I hope you still remember that serine was mentioned as the precursor of cysteine, and then we said methionine forms cysteine. So the case is really a mix of both. We have serine coming from glycolysis joining the product of methionine, which is homocysteine. They go through a reaction catalyzed by an enzyme known as cystathione synthase, and a cofactor, our famous vitamin B6, and then the cystathione goes into a second step to form cysteine again with the aid of cofactor vitamin B6. Now, in case we have methionine synthase deficiency, folate or vitamin B12 deficiency, or if we have cystathione synthase deficiency or cystathione synthase decreased affinity to the vitamin B6, also known as pyridoxal phosphate, homocysteine will build up. This is a disease clinically known as homocystinuria. It's an autosomal recessive disease usually. Those patients tend to have marfanoid habitus. And as a matter of fact, homocystinuria needs to be differentiated from a disease known as Marfan's. They have bone problems such as spine deformity known as kyphosis, osteoporosis, And lens subluxation, remember we have to differentiate between Marfan's and this one. Here the lens subluxation is downward and inward, while in Marfan's it's upward. And more important than all of this is their high risk for thrombosis. Homocysteine in the blood tends to promote clotting, and this thrombosis can lead to catastrophic events such as stroke or MI. Coming back to cysteine, now we know that methionine byproduct, homocysteine, in addition to serine, give us cysteine. A non-protein product of cysteine is glutathione. If you notice the name gluta and thione, thio comes from cysteine and gluta comes from glutamine. So once we reach glutamine, you'll hear glutathione again. Glutathione is an antioxidant, and a clinical correlation here is that there are forms of toxicity in which a medication known as N-acetylcysteine, it's just a manufactured form of cysteine, is given for toxicity. And typical example is acetaminophen toxicity. Now, in relation to proteins, the presence of two cysteines can form a disulfide covalent bond, very strong. It strengthens any protein rich it's in. Now, moving to a final thing is the clinical relation up here, cystinuria. There are forms of reabsorption in the renal system and the GI of cysteine, specifically in the proximal convoluted tubule and in the intestines. And if that fails, that reabsorption, they will tend to accumulate at the renal tubules, and presence of so much cysteine in there will be excreted in high amounts in urine, thus the name cystinuria, but it will not be excreted in the form of cysteine, but rather cysteine. Cysteine is the addition of a cysteine with a cysteine together, and they form that disulfide bond to form cysteine with an. And this cysteine can form hexagonal precipitates in the renal system and lead to renal stones. So this is a clinical hallmark once the urine is examined under microscopy. Now we have asparagine and glutamine. Just as serine and threonine had a hydroxyl group, cysteine and methionine had a sulfur group, asparagine and glutamine have an amine group. And this amine group, just as the oxygen in the serine and threonine, is capable of being involved in post-translational glycosylation at the N-terminal. Once we discuss proteins, you will know that the proteins have an O-terminal and an N-terminal. Now moving on to the synthesis, this is probably the easiest. First of all, the name can hint. Second of all, the structure can hint. Now moving on to the degradation, just as mentioned in the previous video, the main, if I may say, players of amino acids in the urea cycle are the two A's and the two G's, alanine, aspartate, glutamine, and glutamate. And now we have glutamine over here. Glutamine specifically acts as an ammonia carrier. Remember when we said we break the carbon backbone from the amine group and the backbone goes into the energy metabolism cycle? The amine group gets carried into the urea cycle. The carrier of that is glutamine. A clinical association here is, it's beyond the scope of this topic, but there are two diseases in which there are genetic deficiencies of the urea synthesis that eventually lead to elevated urea and elevated glutamine. The urea tends to be toxic to the brain and can eventually lead to coma. Next is aspartate and glutamate. I believe by now a lot is known about those two since they have been mentioned in relation to previous amino acids. Before any chemical conversion, just as glycine was an inhibitory neurotransmitter of the spinal cord, aspartate and glutamate are excitatory neurotransmitters at the level of the brain, especially glutamate is very potent excitatory neurotransmitter. Another characteristic is that if you look up in the table here, you will find that aspartate and glutamate have a negative charge due to a carboxylic acid being. And thus, aspartate and glutamate are present in albumin protein in the blood, and they help the albumin to bind into positive ions, such as calcium ion. We just mentioned in the previous slide that both are synthesized by TCA. Now, glutamate is a precursor of two things. First is GABA, an inhibitory neurotransmitter, which is the opposite to glutamate, and a precursor of glutathione, which we mentioned a slide ago, that it is an antioxidant. You already know that glutamine is an ammonia carrier, while Aspartate is the opposite, it's an ammonia donor. So you expect aspartate to come at the beginning of the urea cycle, giving the amine into the urea cycle, and the glutamine then will take charge by carrying it. Clinical association, this is probably mentioned for the second or the third time, which is related to the liver failure, where the enzymes aspartate transaminase and alanine transaminase are elevated. And reaching the final group of amino acids, the positively charged basic group, starting with arginine. Arginine is synthesized by both proline and glutamine. A good question here to ask is that if it's essential, how is it synthesized? Well, arginine is known to be conditionally essential. That is, it is produced by our body, but not sufficient at rates of excessive growth where there's a lot of DNA being produced and arginine needed at that point. Arginine is also a precursor of nitric oxide, and the cofactor is tetrahydrobiotin. Let's see if you still remember where did we see this cofactor. If you're saying phenylalanine to tyrosine, then perfect, that's correct. Arginine as well is present at the end of the urea cycle. It produces the urea and creatine byproducts. These are toxic products that are excreted. Now moving to histidine. Histidine, by the aid of cofactor vitamin B6, shouldn't be a surprise by now, it produces histamine. Histamine is a hormone that is produced by immunity cells and is implicated in allergies. Now for lysine, if you recall, proline was involved in the collagen crest linking with the aid of vitamin C. Lysine has a similar function in collagen. Now for hemoglobinopathies, I left them aside because they don't fall under a single amino acid. We'll specifically discuss sickle cell disease and hemoglobin C. In sickle cell disease, there is a genetic mutation that alters a single amino acid, being glutamine, to valine. And as you may know, glutamine is negatively charged and valine is neutral. So the net charge is positive 1. While for hemoglobin C, glutamine is negatively charged and lysine is positively charged, creating a net charge of +2. This results in an abnormal hemoglobin and some form of clumping in the red blood cells. What's more important than that is that these charges are used clinically in electrophoresis to diagnose these diseases, where they take a blood sample and the amino acids in the hemoglobin, based on their charge, will move accordingly in the electrophoresis. So let's summarize the most important points we discussed. First of all, we get the essential amino acids from food, and these are the initials of the essential amino acids. And we get, on the other hand, the non-essential being synthesized from glycolysis, and that includes serine and alanine. Serine further produces glycine and cysteine. We have also the tricyclic acid cycle producing glutamine and asparagine, and then that produces the rest. And then we have the non-essential phenylalanine producing tyrosine, and methionine along with serine producing cysteine. Now for the non-protein, majority of them had cofactor vitamin B6, except for a few which had tetrahydrobiotin and vitamin B12. And moving on to the protein, we spoke about collagen in relation to glycine, lysine, and proline cross-linking. For degradation, we mainly mentioned the 2As and the 2Gs, alanine, aspartate, glutamine, and glutamate. And for the energy metabolism, we said the major one to remember over here is alanine, especially in the fasting state. Now, since most of the associations were in the non-protein section, the next slide will have a summary of all the pathways. I would like to note that in the previous video, I mentioned that epinephrine forms non-epinephrine, while it is the other way around. Please note this.